Hi, students. It's Mrs. Cruz. I'm here to read you the second chapter of The Secret of Nim. It's called Mr. Ages. And then once you're done listening to me read it on Google Classroom, there's a new assignment. You're basically going to do the same thing as what you would do if you were in class. So you're going to answer questions like, why did Mrs. Frisbee go to see Mr. Ages? What had Mr. Ages been doing before he came home? Why does Mrs. Frisbee leave in the evening to visit Mr. Ages instead of waiting until the morning when it would be safer? And then you're going to list four character traits of Mr. Ages. And if you don't remember what that means, remember a character trait is something to describe that character. So if you were going to give me character traits, maybe it would be gorgeous, funny, responsible. A mom, right? All those things would be character traits to describe me. So you're going to think of four to describe Mr. Ages, the new character that you see. And then, of course, drawing what's happening in chapter two on the bottom. We're still kind of trying to figure out like how that's going to be sent to me. But if you want to take a picture of it, if you can, and then you send it to me, I'd be happy to put it in like a slideshow like I did last week with shout outs and stuff like that. So, all right. So, chapter two is called Mr. Ages. Enjoy. It's a short chapter, it's only a few pages. Mr. Ages was a white mouse who lived across the farm and beyond in a house that was part of a brick wall. The wall lined the basement of what had once been a large farmhouse. The farmhouse itself had burned down so many years ago that nobody could remember what it had looked like, nor who had lived there. The basement remained a great square hole in the ground, and in its crumbling walls, protected from the wind and snow, numerous small creatures lived. In summer, there were snakes, dangerous to Mrs. Frisbee, but there was no need to worry about them in the winter. Just the same, it was a long, hard journey and could be risky unless you were extremely cautious. It was so far, in fact, that Mrs. Frisbee would not ordinarily have set out so late in the day, for fear that the dark would catch her before she got home. But Timothy obviously could not wait until the next day, so only 5 minutes after she announced that she must go, she was gone. If she had been able to follow her nose, that is, to take the shortest route to where Mr. Ages lived, her journey would have been easy enough. But since that would have led her close to the farmhouse and the barn, and since the cat stalked those grounds relentlessly, she had to plot a much more roundabout way, circling the whole wide farmyard and sticking to the fringe of the woods. She loped along briskly, moving in the easy horse-like canter mice use when they are trying to cover ground. Her progress was almost completely noiseless. She chose her path where the earth was bare or where grass grew, and she avoided dead leaves, which would rustle and crackle even under her small weight. Always she kept an eye out for hiding places, logs, roots, stones, things to scurry under if she should meet a larger animal who might be unfriendly. For though the cat was number one, there were other things in the woods that chased mice. And as she did all this, she worried about Timothy and hoped that Mr. Ages would know something that would help him. If it was more than 2 hours later than sorry, it was more than 2 hours later that she saw she was getting close to the brick wall where he had lived. Though her husband had been a great friend of Mr. Ages and had visited him often, Mrs. Frisbee herself had only been there once before, and that had been in the summer. Still, she remembered the place clearly. It was an odd sort of clearing in the woods. Long ago, when the old house had been lived in before it had burned, there must have been a wide lawn around it. Over the years, the clearing had grown over with a strange mixture of high, rank grass, tall weeds, berries, and wildflowers. In the summer, it was a wild and beautiful place, bright with blooms and full of the smell of blackberry blossoms and purple clover. There were harsher plants as well, spiked jimson weeds and poisonous dark pokeberries, and bees droning everywhere. But in winter, it had a bleak and almost ghostly look, for the blossoms and the green leaves were gone, and only the dry skeleton of the weeds stood, hung with stalks and seeds and pods that rattled in the wind. It was from these seeds and others, and from the flowers and roots beneath them, that Mr. Ages made the drafts and powders that could sometimes save the sick from dying. The time she had been there before, that was for Timothy too, when he was only a baby, scarcely bigger than a marble. He had wandered while playing with the other children, a little away from them, and had been bitten or stung by something poisonous. They did not know what. When the others found him, he lay curled in a ball, paralyzed and scarcely able to breathe. That time, her husband, Mrs. Frisbee, had been alive, and between them, taking turns, they had managed to carry Timothy to Mr. Ages's house. It was a sad and frightening journey, and when they had arrived, they had been afraid he might already be dead. Mr. Ages looked at him, examined his tongue, felt his pulse, and found a small red lump near his neck. "Spider," he said. "Not a black widow, but bad enough." He had forced a few drops of milky liquid into Timothy's mouth and held him upright so it could trickle down his throat, for Timothy could not swallow. In a few minutes, his small muscles had unlocked, and he was able to move his arms and legs. "He'll be all right," said Mr. Ages, "but weak for a few hours." The trip back home had been a happy one, and the other children were wide-eyed with joy to see Timothy alive. Yet Mrs. Frisbee thought that this had been the beginning of his frailness. From that time on, he tended to stumble a little when he walked, especially when he was tired. He never grew as big or as vigorous as his brother Martin, but he thought a great deal more, and in that he resembled his father. Now she reached Mr. Ages's house, a hole in the brick wall where one end of the heavy floor beam had once rested. It was about 2 feet below the top of the wall, and one reached it by climbing down a sort of rough stairway of broken brick ends. She knocked on his door, made of a piece of shingle. "Oh, let him be in, please," she thought, but he was not. There was no answer, so she sat down to wait on the narrow ledge of the brick in front of his door. Half an hour passed, the sun sinking lower in the west all the time, before she heard a slight scratching noise up above, and there he came, carrying a cloth sack bulging with some kind of lumpy material. His fur was a soft gray-white, and so glossy he seemed almost to glow. Mrs. Frisbee had heard that Mr. Ages was not truly a white mouse. That is, he had not been born with white fur, but had turned white from old age. Whether this was so or not, she did not know. Certainly, he seemed very old and very wise, yet he walked nimbly enough. "Oh, Mr. Ages, I'm so glad you've come," she said. "I don't suppose you remember me, Mrs. Frisbee." "Of course I remember you, and I was sad to hear about poor Mr. Frisbee. How is your young son, Timothy, was it?" "It's about him that I've come to see you. He's taken terribly sick." "Has he? I was afraid he might turn out to be not as strong as the others. I hoped you might be able to help him." "That may be. Come in, please, so I can put down this sack." Mr. Ages' house, somewhat larger than a shoebox, but about the same shape, resembled the house of a hermit. It was bare of furniture except for a bit of bedding in one corner, a stool made of a piece of brick, and another piece of brick worn smooth from use as a pestle in which he ground out his medicines. Along one entire wall, arranged neatly in small piles, stood the raw materials he had collected. Roots, seeds, dried leaves, pods, strips of bark, and shriveled mushrooms. To this row he now added the contents of his sack. It held a number of small plants, all of them the same kind, with stringy roots and dark veined greens that looked like mint. I can never say this word. I don't know if you guys can see that. Pipsisewa? Pipsisewa, said Mr. Ages. Botanically, again, see if you can pronounce that. Chymophila umbellata. That's a hard word to say. It said it stays green all winter and makes a very useful spring tonic. Most people use only the leaves, but I have found the roots even more effective. He arranged the plants in an orderly pile. "But that's not what you're here for. What's wrong with young Timothy?" "He has a very high fever. He's delirious. I don't know what to do." "How high?" "So high that he feels burning hot to the touch, runs with perspiration, and yet he shivers with cold at the same time." "Keep him wrapped up in a blanket." "I do." "And his pulse?" "So fast that you cannot tell one heartbeat from the next." "His tongue?" "Is so coated that it looks purple." "How does he breathe?" He breathes very rapidly, and the air rasps in his chest. He said at first that he could not get his breath." "But does not cough?" "No." "He has pneumonia," said Mr. Ages. "I have some medicine that will help him, but the most important thing is to keep him warm, and he must stay in bed." He went to the back of the house, and from a ledge formed by a projecting brick, he took 3 packets of medicine, powders neatly wrapped in white paper. "Give him one of these tonight, mix it with water, and make him drink it. If he is still delirious, hold his nose and pour it down his throat. Give him the second one tomorrow morning, and the third one the next morning." Mrs. Frisbee took the packages. "Will he get better?" she asked, dreading to hear the answer. "He will get better this time. His fever will be less on the second day and gone on the third. after he has taken all the medicine. That does not mean he will have recovered. His lungs will still be terribly weak and sensitive. If he gets to the least bit cold or breathes cold air, even a breath or two, the pneumonia will surely come back worse than before. And the second time, he may not recover. This will be true for at least 3 weeks and more likely a month. And after that, even after that, he should be careful. Though we may hope by then the weather will be warmer. By now the sun was getting low in the west, settling into the high mountains beyond the woods. Mrs. Frisbee thanked Mr. Aegis and set out for home as quickly as she could. Dun, dun, dun. So that's the end of chapter two. What you're going to do next is get onto your Google form, fill out those multiple choice questions, and if you can, take a picture of the drawing that you did and send it to me any way you can, through text message, ClassDojo, email. You could totally email it to me now that we've emailed back and forth. It's up to you. And I'd be happy to put them on our shout out slideshow that we're going to do once a week now. So please feel free to show me pictures, send me pictures. All right. Talk soon. Bye.